Now it's running. Now I can start. Yay!
So, welcome, of course, to creating and altering cosplay patterns. For those who don't know me, my name is Amber. I have been cosplaying for a really, really long time, by which I mean about 13 years. And I've actually been sewing for about 16. I didn't find out about cosplay until I found out about Renaissance festivals. I was like, ooh, I have to have one of those really fancy gowns. And so I had my mother make me one instead. And that was actually my first cosplay experience. I actually started making pillowcases and home ec just like a lot of kids do in middle school. But making patterns for cosplay is actually not as difficult as you might think, even for prop making, and even for the fancy, fancy gowns you might see from, say, Black Butler or Trinity Blood. Everything starts with basic shapes. And everything also starts with basic measurements. So I have developed 5 rules of pattern making. These are very simple to remember. The first is that you have to be honest with yourself. You may see yourself in the mirror every morning in the bathroom as you are taking care of personal hygiene, especially at conventions, and you have to be honest with your measurements. You may want yourself to be smaller or bigger than you are, but part of the point of cosplay is for it to be comfortable. You don't want to sit there and be, you know, hyperventilating throughout the whole convention just to look good, which I know there are cosplayers that do that, and I say more power to you. But I prefer to come back from a convention in one piece, not like a zombie, and my boss appreciates that a lot better too. Especially since I have to go back to work on Monday. So I will be talking about measurements in just a moment. So the first rule is just simply be honest with yourself. The second rule is that patterns can be changed. Just because you have a pattern that says, you must do it this way because this is how the piece says you must cut this piece. This is how the instructions say you have to cut it. Just because it looks like this doesn't mean it has to end up like this. You can always change your patterns. And that brings me to rule 3, which is that patterns can be changed again. If you don't like how you changed it the first time, you can change it again if you want to. You can change a pattern as many times as you want. My recommendation, if you think you're going to need to alter a pattern and it comes from a piece of tissue paper, is to trace it onto a piece of cardboard or poster board first so that you can make your alterations. And if that doesn't work, trace it on another piece of poster board or cardboard and alter it again. That way you don't have to worry about taping tissue paper together, which I have found from experience does not work terribly well. You can do it. Oddly, you can iron tissue paper, but you cannot tape it back together again and have it work very well. Why that is, I still haven't figured that out yet in 13 years. So patterns can be changed as many times as you want to until it works for you. However, once you've sewn it, you can't really change it very much after that. Rule number 4 is measure twice, cut once. If you have not heard that rule before, it means that you measure something 2 times before you even think about picking up your scissors. This is to make sure your measurement is accurate, that your ruler did not mysteriously slip, and you end up with something an entire size smaller than you thought it would be. And I have done this from experience, and I have had hems end up much shorter where I was wearing waders for pants instead of having them go down to the ankle because I did not actually measure the length properly. I found out later my ruler had actually slipped. So measure twice, then cut with your scissors, just to be sure, because you can never be too sure.
Or you measured from the wrong end of the tape measure?
You can also measure from the end that starts with, on this case, 60 instead of 1, and then you end up with 30 inches instead of maybe 16. Yes, there is always that. So make sure you start from 1, at least when you do your measurements. Or if you do start from 60, do it with math. You actually have to add, you're adding work for yourself, so just start from 1. The last rule, as I just mentioned, is as you're working on patterns, don't drop pins on the floor. And I say that just simply because then you're going to come out with a negative impression of pattern making as you are in pain trying to finish your pattern. And you really don't want pattern making to be a negative experience. You want it to be a positive experience, as cosplay should be. So just don't intentionally cause pain to yourself while you are pattern making, which includes while you're taking measurements, incidentally. Don't kill yourself taking measurements. So speaking of measurements, let me start with that. It's gonna be a little more difficult for me with this wig on, but I'm going to show you the basics. Women need 3 measurements, men need 1. These are basic measurements, incidentally. So everybody needs bust, and they still call it bust for men on occasionally, but sometimes they'll call it chest. And that's not meant to be, you know, gender specific, that's just pattern terminology. So you measure across the fullest part of the bust. Again, be honest with yourself. When you do this, wear undergarments so that you have your true size. Again, you know, be honest with yourself. Don't pull it too tight. You want it to be a nice, relaxed measurement because you don't want your cosplay to not allow you to breathe. So make sure that you can take a nice deep breath because you may need to do that at some point so that your costume will breathe with you. If you use commercial patterns, incidentally, they have something built in called ease. The only thing that eases is a little bit of additional measurement to make sure that the clothes are not form-fitting so that you can actually breathe and move in the clothing. That's all it means is. Second measurement is waist. This is not where you think it is. This is actually about 2 inches below your belly button. That's where waist is when you take your waist measurement. It's not actually at your belly button. It's 2 inches below. And same thing applies, nice and relaxed measurement. Last one for women is hips. And again, you take it probably about 7 inches below your belly button for hips for women. The reason that women need 3 and men need 1 is not because they want women to have more work. It is because they're assuming that women are shaped like this, to where you have a thicker part on top, a thinner part in the middle, and then a thicker part on bottom. They're operating under the assumption that men are shaped like this. Which, if you're shaped like that, it may work really easily for you. But if you're not, then you may have to take additional measurements. If you are working with something called a sloper, they're also called blocks, which are basically custom-made patterns for your exact body measurements. If you're working with those, you may actually need an additional set of measurements. You may need to take up to 15 additional measurements. And the reason I say this, because when you're making slopers, you're basically drawing shapes from scratch, so you may end up with a spreadsheet that looks like this. These are all of my body measurements that I had to take. You can see there's a lot of measurements on there. And I'll talk about slopers later and why you need so many. So if you're doing commercial patterns, you need 3 for women, 1 for men. If you're doing slopers, you may need up to 15. Either way, take your measurements and write them down somewhere so that you don't forget them. Because you'll try and remember what your measurements were and you'll make your costume based on those measurements, and then you won't be those measurements anymore. Which I have actually done on commission. Somebody changed size from what they told me they were, and their costume did not fit, and I could not actually expand it. So that's doubly important for commissioners. All right, purchasing the correct pattern. This is if you're working with commercial patterns for cosplay. When you go to the store, usually Joann's, Hobby Lobby, your local hobby store, they'll come in a little envelope like this. And I have mine in a plastic bag. Mostly because once you take the tissue paper out and you iron it, and then you actually cut it out, and then you fold it back up, it does not fit back in the bag. So I end up having to keep mine in a Ziploc baggie just because I cannot get mine to fit back in the package. But they look like this. They've got a whole bunch of measurements and stuff on the bottom. And this is where you match your measurements. Now you may not match the exact measurements in the row that they have on here. Choose the biggest one, because that way you have access to work with if you need it. You don't want to have not enough, because adding fabric on tends to yield extra seams or really ugly seams. Yeah, you guys can move up if you want to. When you're purchasing it for a specific cosplay, such as the one I'm wearing, this is actually based off of a simplicity pattern that I had to alter. You want to get as close to the end result as you can get, because it's less work for you. You know, you don't want to be sitting there working a year on a costume if you don't want to, right? We all have better things to do with our time, usually. So you want, for this one, I bought a kimono pattern because it resembles a kimono, and that's as close as I want it to get. So you want to try and at least get close. A lot of costume lines now have specific costume patterns. So you can get like Lord of the Rings patterns now. You can get Star Wars patterns. You can get patterns for Japanese kimonos. So they actually have started specifically making these because cosplayers say, you know, I need this. I need it to look like this. Can you make me one? And every year they come out with new costume patterns. In fact, McCall came out this year with patterns on how to make gloves, pouches, boots, and gauntlets for those who are making armor cosplays. In fact, I think Butterick has come out with armor patterns that you can use now. And they have historical lines that are specifically meant for costumers. So that's something to look into because it's, again, less work for you. If you can't find anything that's really close to what you need, you may just have to start with a basic pattern and work from there, or you may have to turn to slopers, as I'm going to talk about later. When you purchase your fabric, make sure you get extra, especially if you plan on altering, because you may find that when you cut out a piece and you pin fit it, either to your dress form or to yourself, that it really doesn't fit the way you thought it would, and that it's not a salvageable piece, and you have to cut another one. And does anybody not know about dye lots in fabric? Okay, it looks like, okay. Dye lots are basically whenever you dye fabric, they dye it in a lot or a group at a time. And because fabric is dyed in lots, you may get slightly different color variations between groups of fabrics. So just because two fabrics are purple does not mean they are the exact same color purple. This is why you buy extra, in case you have to cut an extra piece so that the colors all match. It is very evident when you have different dye lots in your costume, believe me, especially under lighting like this. So that's why I usually tell people, if you're gonna alter, or if you think you're gonna alter, just buy a little bit of extra. It is a little extra money, but you'll thank yourself later. Incidentally, if you guys have questions while I am talking about this, feel free to raise your hand and stop me. Or if you have tips or tricks to add, I'm certainly open to those as well, because I'm always learning too. So if you have something, yes.
What about, what about altering men's patterns for women?
Those are a little bit different. What you will need to do, make sure you have the correct measurements, and what you may have to do is take the pattern. In fact, I will draw this out for you. Hopefully this will not fall. So you have, say, a men's vest pattern, like this. And of course they assume you're almost flat as board, so I'm gonna draw it that way. Like this. Women are not shaped like this, right? Like, you can all agree, women are generally not shaped like this. What you're going to have to account for, if this is chest and this is waist, is you're going to need extra fullness here, because women are curvy up top. And so you will need to actually increase this measurement a little bit to accommodate for the women's bust measurement. You may have to add something that are called darts here, so that it will pull around the curve, so that it doesn't look like you're wearing a potato sack. Which you can do, if that's what your costume calls for, go ahead and do the potato sack thing. But does anybody not know what darts are? Okay, let me go over darts really quickly. If you have a circle, a 2D piece of fabric, just a circle, that you're trying to fit over a 3D shape, like one's chest, or say a globe, or an orange, or something, if you try and just hang it over that 3D shape, you're gonna get a lot of wrinkles and a lot of ugliness that doesn't look very smooth, like say the top of an orange. So what you do is you cut out little chunks like this, and you literally cut out the fabric. You cut out a triangle and you take that triangle away, so that when you join those two pieces of fabric, it starts to round off the shape, and then it fits better over the 3D, the globe. And that's why a lot of women's patterns have darts that go, say, up to here, and sometimes they'll even have side darts. It's to make the fabric conform around the curve better so that there's less fabric there. Yes?
When you cut out darts, do you go in or out?
Define in and out.
Like, when you're cutting and then there's a dart, do you cut into the fabric or do you cut out into, like, the outside?
For waist darts, because there's three kinds of darts. There's waist darts, there's side darts, and there's back darts. For waist darts, it's always from the waist up like this. For side darts, it's always from the side seam, like this. For back darts, it's from the back, the bottom of your back, up. So you're always cutting up toward your torso, you're always cutting in toward your torso. That's how darts work. Incidentally, and I made this point in my armor panel yesterday, but I'll make it again just so that you guys know. When you cut darts, if this is the center of the circle, the deeper you cut the dart toward the center, the more pointed your pyramid is going to be, and you'll get a Katy Perry look. So if you want to cut darts, usually you'll have them more shallow so that you get a more rounded dome instead. Now, you can go for the pointed pyramid look if that's what your costume calls for, but this is just so that you know, the deeper the dart, the more pointed your end result is going to be. So for women's patterns, if you're converting from men's, you'll probably have to add at least two darts here, and possibly side darts here. And then you'll basically cut the waist in to match the waist measurement, which will probably be smaller than the men's. And then that should conform it better to women. Now, of course, you may still have to drape and pinfit. I mean, that goes for any kind of pattern. I did this year. I made a costume without trying it on. I never pinfitted. I didn't have time. I just made it and prayed. And it's actually the one I'm wearing right now.
Wow.
Which I did that to make a point because I'm not happy with the fit. And this is what happens when you don't pin fit it, is because this costume, I did not alter to my body proportions. This is made for a Mrs. Teenager. I had to enlarge it, and I have something that's called low bust, which means that my chest is lower than average than what the pattern was built for. So my darts are actually here. You can see it on the side. You can see the point right here. This is my dart. That dart is supposed to be over here. And it's because I didn't actually take the time to fit the costume and wear it before I actually brought it to the con. So that's why it's important to pin fit your pattern first before you even sew the whole thing. And then you won't have my problem, which I will be fixing this when I get home. Just because I like to have clothing that fits. I like it to look right on me. Yes?
I have a tip for finding patterns.
Sure.
Like, a lot of times, especially with anime costumes, it tends to be like what would be normal clothes, but with like really exaggerated features, like a like huge collar or like mm-hmm. big sleeves or something. And a lot of times, I found.
You can stand up if you want to, so that everybody can see.
Like this shirt and stuff, I've found like a what would be considered like a high fashion thing. Mm-hmm. I like looked in that section of Joann's and got a really like enormous collar and just started fitting it down, and that's where like, mm-hmm. a lot of.
You can actually find a lot of the clothing in what they consider evening wear or prom dresses for women, and they have suits for men. They also have the real nice dress shirts for men if you need that sort of look too. So don't be afraid to walk in there, you know, and poke around in the pattern section. They've also got pattern books, incidentally, that you can look through too, just to get ideas. Yes?
I have a tip also.
Sure.
My personal favorite store is Hobby Lobby, and like once a month or once every 2 months, they have like a huge sale mm-hmm. on patterns, and you can get them for $1 instead of spending $17. And although I don't sew right now, I do have a huge collection so that when I do start sewing, I have everything I already need.
I highly advocate waiting for sales. Joann's runs them every 6 weeks. Other stores run them about every 4 to 6 weeks. And they're always, you know, blank brand patterns for a buck. And you can do that. Usually I end up buying up to 10 just so that I have them for the future. I don't have any idea of what I'm going to do with them now. But I might need them later. And then when I do need them later and I have it, I'm grateful I did, because patterns go out of print. If you did not know, patterns are no longer printed after a certain period of time. And then the only place you can really find them is eBay. And then they overcharge you for them because they know they're out of print. Or you can try and borrow them from a cosplayer friend who's willing to scan them for you. So that's something to keep in mind whenever you're looking for patterns, is they're not going to be there forever. Which is unfortunate, because some of the best patterns that I like using, they don't make any more, and I don't have mine anymore. When you do your pattern pieces for commercial patterns, they will they'll cut them in halves. They'll only give you the left half of a costume, incidentally. This is the left half, I think. It should say center front somewhere. Oh, okay, it's this half. My left, you're right. And this is because they expect you to mirror it. They expect you to, it'll say cut on fold. This is so that they save paper. So when you see it this way, it's not because they only want you to make half the costume. Mm-hmm. It's because they expect you to kind of know to flip it over and make the other side of it. So please remember to actually do that, or to cut on fold whenever you have your pattern pieces. That goes for sleeves. Flip sleeves over, because sleeve caps actually do have a shape to them. Sleeves are not just shaped like this. Sleeve caps actually have a short end, and then they'll have a long end. This is why you have to flip it over whenever you make the other side, so that it's mirrored. Otherwise, you have two left sleeves, and I've done that way too many times. This is why I use broadcloth, because then both sides are the same, so if I mess up, I can just flip it over and say it's the right side. Have I mentioned I'm a really lazy sewer sometimes? Lazy and cheap sometimes, but that's okay, because you can still make fantastic costumes when you are both lazy and cheap. If you need to join pattern pieces together, for example, for skirts or pants, you can do that. I recommend just using masking tape or double stick tape so that you can take them apart. Don't use duct tape. You will never get them apart again without ruining your pattern. I have not actually done that, mostly because I'm not a fan of duct tape, but it's sticky enough that you will never get your pattern pieces apart again. If you use poster board, that's okay. Not on tissue paper. You can change the type of seams that are already in commercial patterns. If you have a seam, particularly this goes for shirts and skirts, I always draw these without sleeves, mostly because sleeves are actually the bane of my existence, and I'm not really generally a fan of them. If you have something, what they call an empire seam, which is the one that runs right underneath the bust, usually it's used in pajamas. If you don't like this seam, you can take this out of a pattern. Because they've accounted for you not sewing here, realistically, if it's just one piece of fabric, you can just erase it. If it's two, if you cut it as two separate pieces of fabric, this goes for any seam, what you will need to do is take your two pieces and overlap them right at that seam so that you'll kind of have this effect. And the center areas where they overlap, does this make sense so far? When you overlap your pieces of fabric because you're taking out the seam allowance. When you have two separate pieces of fabric and they want you to sew them together, in addition to the edge of the fabric, they've accounted for the fact that you're going to actually add 5/8 of an inch. They have added seam allowance whenever you have two separate pieces of fabric. So whenever you want to join them as one piece, you have to take away that extra. Does that make sense? Okay, I just want to make sure. If I don't make sense for some reason, at least more than normal, let me know. That same concept applies with princess seams. And you can see this both in men's clothing and women's. Princess seams are the ones that run here. And they call it this because it gives it a slimming effect, like princess dresses would have, and that's why they call it that. Empire seams are meant to display something else that I won't talk about in this panel, but that's why they're called that. So princess seams, same way. Usually with this, these are separate pieces. You won't ever find a princess seam shirt in one piece. I really wish you could, because that would be awesome. So whenever you have separate pieces, again, just overlap right around where it says the seam should be so that you take out that seam allowance and then retrace the larger pattern piece onto something, poster board, cardboard, what have you. You could also use tissue paper, incidentally, from the store.
So how would you add a princess seam?
If you want to add it to a one piece, something that's already one piece, okay, then what you would do, and I'm actually going to discuss this a little more in depth than draping, but I will go ahead and tackle it now. So you have one piece. You know that what you're going to have to do with princess seams is you're going to have to cut this up because you can't keep it in one piece. So the first thing you need to do is figure out where your seams are going to go and how they're going to curve. Because, you know, you can have a princess seam that only curves like that. You can have a really deep princess seam. I mean, just decide how much you want it to curve. It may take a little experimentation on your part to figure out what looks best on you. So you draw in your seams on your pattern, on your one-piece pattern. So it'll look like this. Then you have to actually cut it along those lines. So now you have three pieces. Three, sir, three. Then on each piece, so I'm going to erase this line as if this piece is not here. So if I just have this one piece, and I know I'm going to have to stitch along this line, I now have to add 5/8 of an inch when I make my pattern, like that. So you add the seam allowance. And you're going to do the same to each and every piece wherever you're going to have a stitching line. See, I don't have to add it up here, because I haven't changed that. I haven't added or subtracted anything, so I don't have to change that seam. But I do have to do it along the ones I did. So that goes for this seam right here too. It'll go for this side and this side. I have to add that 5/8 inch. You don't have to do 5/8, incidentally. 5/8 is just the standard. You can add 3/8, you can add 1/8, you can do whatever you want. I usually use a 1/2 inch, but that's just my own personal preference. Most sewing machines will have little sewing guides that show you where 3/8 is, where 5/8 is, so that you know how deep your seam allowance is. So that is actually how you add seams. And I'll do that in draping here in just a little bit on my dress form, which hopefully will not fall. Good morning. If you want to alter and do large alterations on commercial patterns, you may have to sacrifice your pattern and cut into it a lot. By which I mean, if I actually need to add a large amount to the outside and say change the shape of this armhole and extend this portion, this is a pattern I have planned on sacrificing, so I am sorry, my good pattern, I'm going to cut it. What you would do is lay it out, probably on a piece of poster board or whatever you're going to trace it on. Take your other piece and move it to where your measurements are. So you're going to look for, say, the chest measurement. You're going to line it up to where you need the chest measurement to be. You'll line it up to where you need the waist to be, like maybe that. Then you'll tape it down to your poster board and you will trace the new lines around your pattern. Make sense? Yes? Okay. So if you need to actually cut out pieces of patterns, normally this is more common on pants and skirts when you have to change the waist circumference and when you have to change the side seam, which side seam is just from waist down to feet. That's all the side seam is. So if you need to do that to your pattern, be prepared to sacrifice it like I just did. Or trace it on a piece of poster board first. Make sure you include important markings on it, such as darts, and then cut it instead if you want to save your pattern piece, which I'm probably going to end up taping that back together later anyway. So that is how to make large alterations. If you just need minor alterations, such as maybe expanding the chest by a little bit, you can simply take your pattern. In fact, I probably need to redraw this. But you would take your pattern and you would simply redraw the lines. And a really useful tool to have whenever you have to redraw lines, especially curves, is something called a French curve set. So if I have my neckline, and I have my uber lovely vest, if I need to extend the chest size just a little bit, then what I may end up doing is just measure how much I need for the chest to be additional, and then just redraw my line here, just so that it matches the measurements. You'll notice I didn't actually bring this out, because I don't necessarily have to change this measurement. You only want to redraw the parts you need to change. If I were to bring this out, then I'd end up having a cap sleeve. My sleeve would come out to like here, if I were to change that measurement too. So of course, changing one measurement does kind of change all of the others. So how am I doing on time? I'm doing okay. All right, I'm going to tackle slopers unless anybody has any questions, comments, or concerns thus far. Nope, okay, I'm going to go ahead and move on. Slopers are usually not taught in sewing classes, which is why I'm going to cover them. It will help you greatly if you have a book or the internet to help you. This book is called Making Your Own Patterns. And what it has inside, where's the right page? It basically has detailed instructions on how to make each of the different pieces. There we go. Instructions on how to take all the different measurements that you just took and make your own custom pattern. Bear in mind that the formulas that they're using do involve a lot of math, which is unfortunate sometimes. But they're also based on an average body shape, so that when you make these slopers in a way they kind of end up like commercial patterns where they assume that you're going to end up shaped like this or like this. So you may actually have to alter from even what they tell you in the book. What they're going to do, I'm going to use this, so they're going to say, okay, draw a dot, label it A, okay? I've done that. Now say, take your back measurement, your center back from the back of your neck to the bottom of your back. Draw a line, label the other end B. Reminds you of geometry class, doesn't it? So they have you do that. And then they'll say, okay, take your shoulder measurement, say from the neck to the end of your shoulder. Okay, so I've got there, okay. And then they'll say, okay, draw something between 4 and 5 inches long. I'll do that, okay. And then you start getting the general shape of what's going to be a pattern piece. And that's kind of how slopers work. They basically tell you, okay, take all of your measurements and draw the basic shape based on your measurements, which is why slopers tend to fit you better than commercial patterns do.
I had a question.
Yeah.
Now, when measuring things like your center front and center back,
mm-hmm.
is it from your center place, like how far underneath do you like to go from like your armpit area where you, when you close?
Usually what I like to do is to wear an old t-shirt because that way I can see where the side seams are. And usually I try and wear a very close fitting shirt so that it doesn't change my measurements too much. But that way I can at least see where the collar starts because neck measurement is one of them. So I can see where I want my collar to fall. I can see where the side seams are. I can easily see where my waist falls and the bottom of my back, which is actually like really hard for me to see when I'm taking a measurement. It's even hard to do when I'm looking in a mirror. So having the shirt helps me to see where those things are so I know where to start the measurement.
Well, I mean, for different people, like, you know, they have different torso lengths. So,
right.
I mean, there's some people that say, you know, measure from underneath the arm or measure from your, you know, your nipple height or measure from, like, certain things. Like, what, in your experience, what kind of effect do you like to go for, I mean, for people that you've done work for or for yourself, like...
Usually, I at least try and keep to basic shapes so that I know if it's going to fit like a t-shirt, then I will measure it like a t-shirt. So I'll wear a t-shirt while I'm actually doing. And if the pattern book calls for me to measure, say, from side seam to side seam, and I know that what they're intending that for is the bust, then instead of measuring underneath, I will measure across the fullest part to make sure I include that. So basically, I usually read through the instructions first, incidentally, to see what the measurements are for, so that I know what their intent is when I use these. And then I will take that measurement and use it. I mean, you don't have to use this as a Bible, like I said. If you need to change any of the measurements you take, you can do that. And nobody will be offended. So, yes?
One thing, especially for ladies, when mm-hmm. you're taking your measurement, you said wear our undergarments.
Yes.
Try and wear the ones you're going to wear under your costume.
Yes.
Different things change your shape.
Yes. And for ladies who are cross-playing or men who are cross-playing, should you intend to bind or stuff, you must do that when you are taking your measurements if that is the costume you are going to be wearing. And I don't say this to be like blunt, but I am saying it to be blunt. You basically have to have whatever shape you're going to have when you wear that costume. So whatever it is you're going to do, do it, then take your measurements. Now you are going to change measurements slightly if you are, say, working out. And you expect, say, your biceps to change, or if you expect your chest or waist to change. You can account for that, but normally what I tell people to do, because I've actually had this problem, is go with the larger measurement, because you can always take clothing in. It's really hard to take clothing out if you run out of seam allowance. So, you know, if you think you're going to get bigger working out, add a couple of inches to your pattern size. There's nothing wrong with it. You can always trim it off later if you don't need it. So just make sure that whatever it is you're going to do beforehand, do that. Great tip. Slopers can be altered in the same way that commercial patterns are. And this, incidentally, is a French curve set. You can find this in the artist section of hobby stores. All it is a bunch of different sets of curves. These happen to be clear. They come in many colors. And there's many different types of curves, as you can see. These help you whenever you're trying to retrace curves on a pattern. You see there's all different, there's even little swirls if you need them. But these I have found to be a godsend whenever you're trying to redraw, say, skirt curves, or even changing the shape of armholes. These are really helpful. So if you need to take your slopers, which these are actually my personal slopers, you'll probably have a set. You'll have a bodice, or for men, I guess it would still be called a bodice for men, because it's basically for a shirt or vest. This one has darts. You may not necessarily need one that has darts. And you can see all my different measurements here. And I traced these onto butcher paper, which is actually really inexpensive to get. I've also saved the packing paper from my parents' Christmas gifts and used that on occasion. And I've also used newspaper, although it's a little harder to see on newspaper. This is a dartless pattern. Oddly enough, this is for a shirt. It may look a little long for a shirt, but this is actually because what they'll have you do is measure just past your waist so that you've got a little bit of, you know, overhang in case your pants happen to hang low. But these actually fit me a lot better than a commercial pattern does. So you'll probably have a set for a shirt, you will have a set for pants, and you will have a set for sleeves, which you'll also have front and back of shirt, incidentally, because you don't want to just have fronts or just have backs, because then you only have half a shirt. So you'll have front and back. This is a sleeve pattern. And you can see they'll have you put in darts. This happens to be an elbow dart, but I don't have to use it if I don't want to. So you'll have a set for sleeves. If you want short sleeves, you can always alter it and cut it off early. If you want to, same thing goes with shirts. You can always cut them off early if you need to. This is another one with darts. These are different darts. You can see these are actually diamond-shaped darts instead of the triangles I showed you earlier. This just gives a different shape to the shirt. Usually you'll see this on dress shirts, particularly for women, because men usually don't have to shape down here. And I didn't bring the pant leg, but it's okay. So you'll have a set for each different thing. You may have about 5 different collar patterns, actually, because as we all know, anime has 10,000 different collar types. You get your Mandarin collar, you get your sailor collar, you get what they call the revers collar, which is the lapel that you find on suits normally. There's all different kinds of collars, and they'll have you make a different pattern for each, based on your measurements. When you do the slopers, as soon as you're done, fit it to you. Because I actually found out later on that after I had made these, the slopers don't fit me. Even though they're using my measurements, they're not using my proportions. Because I am low, so the sloper kind of assumed that I ended up here instead of down here. And so I did not pin fit them, and again, it's another, do as I say, not as I do. Learn from my experience, pin fit the slopers to you. Or to your dress form if you happen to have the proportions of a dress form, to make sure it actually really does fit you, even though it has your measurements. All right, I'm going to go into draping. Unless anybody, again, questions, comments, concerns, suggestions, tips, tricks. Anybody? Everybody still awake? Okay, good. I know it's getting close to lunchtime. When you drape, you will probably have a dress form unless you have a friend to help drape over you. If you drape over yourself, same rules apply as with pin fitting. Bind or stuff as you're going to, wear undergarments, wear close-fitting clothing. And then you will start with a blank piece of fabric, which this is basic broadcloth. I just pulled a piece out of my 8 paper boxes worth of scrap that I have at home. You will start with just a basic piece. You'll probably start with about a yard on either side, so 2 yards total, if you are making a shirt. You may need to start with longer if you have, say, a dress or a longer shirt. Draping pants on a dress form is actually entirely difficult. So I'm going to start with the shirt. I think I covered up my scissors. Yep, there we go. So the first thing you want to do when you're draping is you want to make a hole for your neck because you need a place for your neck to go. So I measured the center of the fabric, and then I marked out an approximate circumference on each side, and I'm going to cut out a little half circle of this so that it fits over my dress form. So I'm going to do that really quickly. You will usually do this with your own neck circumference, incidentally, because you may not have the same neck circumference as this dress form, which actually has a very thin neck. Some dress forms will allow you to change the circumference of the neck, and I highly recommend that you change and double check the dress form before you fit to it and make sure it has the measurements you need before you make a costume that's too big or too small for somebody. All right. So then you can see I have a hole in the center for the neck. Is that, it's not a very beautiful hole, but it will work for this. You put it over like that. And you can see that it's very, very drapey right now. There's not much form to it because I included a lot of fabric crosswise. If you're making, say, a sleeveless shirt or a vest, you may want to cut the fabric off here. You see about where the shoulder is on the dress form right here? You may want to actually cut the fabric off here instead because that way you don't have all of this excess just sitting there. If you're going to make sleeves, you may choose to leave this on here if you're doing something called raglan sleeves, which are attached directly to the shirt. There's no like extra sleeve portion. If you're doing separate sleeves, I would just cut it off here and drape a separate sleeve because you'll be happier with the result. I'm gonna leave this on here for right now, just for show. Normally I would be cutting it off right here. The first thing you want to do is you'll pull in fabric here along the side where you can see it. Hopefully that does not go down. You'll pull in until you can see it's fairly tight fitting here. See, it fits pretty tightly around the dress form. And then I'm going to let go just a little bit. This is, I'm accounting for ease, for comfort of fit. And then what I would do is take my scissors, whoops, and I will cut, and this is for the side seam. And I would cut all the way up until where I hit the sleeve or the armhole area. I'm trying not to cut my dress form. I'm just gonna loop that over. So you can see, despite my hideous cut, this is now the side seam. And then I would pin this just to make sure that it fits and that I have adequate ease. As you can see, I've got a pretty good amount of ease here. This would be my side seam. Unfortunately, they usually don't have dress forms fitted for men. I have not yet found one yet. All the dress forms I have ever seen are shaped like this. So you can get one that has adjustable dials on it, like this, and you can change it to a point to men's measurements. But what you may have to do is simply account for extra ease here where women would normally pull in at the waist. So if you're sewing for men, give it a little bit extra here, so that, you know, you don't have the slimming effect where you don't necessarily need it.
Or make a duct tape dummy.
Yes, you can make a duct tape dummy if you do make duct tape dummies for patterning. You have to have a friend help you do it, unless you're really good at duct taping yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And what you do is you wear a t-shirt you are willing to sacrifice, because you are going to sacrifice that shirt.
Mm-hmm.
And you buy about two or three rolls of duct tape, and you literally have them tape you into the shirt. Depending on how you want the duct tape dummy, you may also have them tape up to part of the sleeve so that you have something to form over. You probably don't want them to actually tape you long sleeve into it, unless that's really what you want, simply because then you can't move. And once they have taped you into the shirt, you get a really heavy duty pair of scissors, and they have to cut you out of it from the back. And basically you can't move until they're done. And then you have a duct tape dummy that you tape back together, you tape up the seam that they cut you out of, and then you stuff it, usually either with stuffing, I've seen people use newspaper. You probably wouldn't want to use something like sand or kitty litter because then it's going to weigh about 60 pounds, and then you can't carry it around. So you want to stuff it with something that you can carry around as needed. I find that the one disadvantage to duct tape dummies, actually there's two disadvantages. The first one is that you cannot really pin into them. You can't use pins like this because the adhesive on the duct tape is going to get all over your pins and it's going to make them really nasty and gross. So unless you want to clean your pins every time after you're done using them, then, you know, you may want to consider getting a dress form instead. Yes?
We make cape sculptures in art school and we use clear packing tape. And so if you do enough layers of clear packing tape, you don't have the duct tape adhesive problem.
Right.
You actually don't have to use a t-shirt. You roll it or you sticky side up.
Okay.
One way, and then you go back over it several times.
Got it.
So you don't have to sacrifice a t-shirt.
Okay.
Your clothing still may get accidentally dipped. You have to be careful.
Right.
But if you don't want a t-shirt inside of it, you can just use clear packing tape that way. It's a lot easier, and you can buy it, you know, in bulk. So.
That's actually a great idea. I may have to finagle my co-host into doing this after the convention. Yes, but you know, if that's what helps people cosplay, then I am all for it. Yes.
Either I was going to ask about the duct tape form. If you were to make it, would it be best to like buy a stand for it to stand it up, or would you like?
It's honestly going to depend on where you're going to work with it, because if you have a table like this that you can sit it on at home, and you're going to draft shirts or vests or something that basically sits on top of the form, you can just sit it on top of the table. And you don't need a stand. But if you're going to be working with it freestanding somewhere, say in your living room, you'll probably either want to purchase one, or you can just make one out of plywood. It's really cheap. It's less than $5 to get plywood for it.
Flagpole holder also works really well.
I'm sorry?
A flagpole holder also works.
Yes, flagpoles work. PVC pipe also works. And if you have access to a cement block, then you can just mount it in a cement block, and that thing's not going anywhere.
We did a full duct tape form of my roommate, and because he's a large man, and we used PVC for the skeleton.
Yes. If you're going to use your dress form for a long period of time, you'll probably want to make sure it can take a beating, so you'll want to use good materials. The other disadvantage I want to just touch on really briefly, and then I'll get your question, is that if you change size dramatically, like for some reason, if you have, say, gastric bypass surgery, or if you end up losing a lot of weight, or if you end up gaining a lot of weight, your duct tape dummy is useless, simply because that is the shape you were, and if you change dramatically from that, you have to make a new one, which it's more of just a time inconvenience. It's not a huge deal. It's just one of those disadvantages that if you happen to change size, you just have to make a new one. Yes?
Another important tip if you're doing the tape dummy is for ladies, unless you're going to be doing crossfly, if you just go in a circle around your chest, you're going to compress your chest. You actually have to do an X to cup the breasts so that you can do straight around, and then you actually didn't have to make boobs to attach to it. So just don't go straight around because you're going to compress your chest.
I'm going to draw that really quick on a diagram for those who may not know or did not hear. If you have a person standing here, then when you do your duct tape, you have to do it in an X, like this. Mostly for ladies, simply because we are a bit rounder, more rotund up top. And that is just to preserve the shape so that you have an accurate duct tape dummy to form off of. The only reason I use a dress form is simply because it's adjustable so that if I change size, I can change its size, and generally it matches my measurements. Now, it does not match my proportions, so I cannot use it for form-fitting things like armor, which is unfortunate. I will eventually have to have a duct tape dummy for that, which is why I'm going to get clear packing tape after the con so I can have one. When you need to draw in seams on here, you basically have two options. You can draw it in with a pen if you want to. The issue with that is that if you mess up, now you have a giant seam drawn on your thing. So what I usually have people do is either use seamstress tape or just plain ribbon. And what you can do, this is where I'm going to tell myself, I'm not going to draw pins. So you'll take the ribbon and you will pin it in place. If I don't stab myself first. And you will pin it where you want your seams. Particularly, this is in the front and in the back, so that if I want my seam to start here at the shoulder, then I will pin it here, and then I will simply move the ribbon to where I need it to go. And then I will just keep pinning it where I need it. And then once you're done and you're happy with where you want the seam, then you will take the pen, or whichever you're doing your marking with, and you will trace this line, and then you remove the ribbon. Unless you want to glue the ribbon down, which you can do, but usually for seam lines, you're going to cut along these lines. What you're doing is basically tracing cutting lines. So you eventually, whenever you trace it, you're just going to snip it right up that line. So that's why I like to use ribbon, because it's also reusable, so I don't have to worry about, you know, if I mess up, I don't have to start over. I can just unpin the ribbon, and voila, I've got my piece back to where it was. This also can go for darts. If you want to try and form your darts, you can use ribbon for that. You'll also want to mark out on your pattern not only where bust points are for women and where chest falls for men, but you'll also want to mark on your pattern or on your dress form where the waist falls, because that is a very important point, especially if you plan on wearing belts, because this is a fantastic place if you need to put a seam, because you can hide it with a belt. In fact, I have a seam right here, but it's covered up with all my obis, with all of my bows and obis. So if you need to put a seam here, you need to know where it falls so you can hide it. And then, of course, you need to mark where the waist falls if you have a long shirt. It's going to matter more for pants than it is for shirts, but if you have a long shirt, you do need to mark where that falls. You can use different color ribbon for different color things if you want to. I usually end up saving my patterns after I've drafted them. I keep them in a very large paper box collection. But I like to keep them because I actually do use them for other things. Even though I may have drafted a pattern piece, say for a piece of armor, then I can actually use it for something else. When I do prop patterns, I do it on poster board, and I grid it out in inches. Because what I use is something called the relative method instead of the proportional method. Proportional basically just means that you look at a picture of your character, like so. Have a picture of character who is hopefully not a stick figure, because it's really hard to make patterns for stick figure. And then of course you have you. So you measure dude in picture, or dudette, as you prefer. You should probably know your own height at this point. And then you make a proportion. And then for everything else that you want to make for yourself in this picture, you compare the size of it in the picture to the size that it should be on you, and you do a bit of math. This is the long way to do it, to be honest, because you're doing a lot of work. The way that I tend to do it, also because of my proportion, is the relative method, which is to say, on stick figure dude in picture, so I have Mr. Stick Figure here, who happens to be wearing a shirt, which is actually now really hard to draw because I did that wrong. There we go. Okay, he's wearing a really bad shirt. And if I see that the sleeve, you know, falls just past his elbow, then my sleeve needs to fall just past my elbow, regardless of how long it is. It doesn't really matter about the actual measurements. It just has to fall to the same place and end up in the same place on me as it does on them. So that's a lot less math, but it means I have to do a lot more guesswork and visualization. So if you're a visual person, this may work better for you. If you're a math person, you may prefer the proportional method. Both of them work equally well. So when I grid out my poster board, I am doing a little bit of math just to make sure my sides are mirrored, and the French curves help with that. But I'm doing a lot of guesswork to see, okay, you know, does this actually fall where it needs to? No. Okay. And you can see where I actually had to tape poster board together because I went short and I had to extend my pattern. So I had to tape it together and guess again. And this ended up being my final piece. I do that with all of my props and with accessory pieces that are on my costumes, for example, things like bows. I do it for that too on poster board. I cut my patterns in half if I need to store them and just make sure that they are mirrored. This is actually for a bow. And I do these on poster board too. And I have always used the relative method just to see, okay, well, the bow is supposed to be about 5 feet high. Okay, so I know my pattern's supposed to be about 5 feet high. Okay, that looks about right. And if it doesn't, I add or subtract more as I need to. These are my armor patterns. You can see I actually keep mine on manila envelopes. This is for Lena Inverse, incidentally, for those who are curious. And again, I keep these because I may not use it for Lena, I may use it for something else. But I did the same method. I cut out a general shape. I basically cut out a big diamond that was bigger than this. And I held it here and went, okay, does that look long enough? Okay, it looks about long enough. does it wrap around to the correct length? Because I want it to at least cover my shoulder, since armor actually has a purpose. It's to protect your shoulder, so I wanted it to wrap around. So I went, okay, does it wrap around enough? No, okay, I need to add more. Okay, is it wrap around enough? Okay, so that works. It's a lot of guesswork, to be honest, in patterning, but as you practice it more and more, you get used to being able to guess and to visualize, say, how long 4 inches is. It's an art, it really is. But as you get used to it, you'll get faster at it, and it won't be such a chore. And I've kind of gotten to the point where I actually enjoy pattern making. I really enjoy the construction aspect of cosplay. And all of my patterns are free. I'm happy to upload any of them to the internet if anybody wants them, because I honestly think that everybody should be able to cosplay whatever they want to. And if they need help making a pattern, then they should be able to have all the help they need, because the point is that you should enjoy cosplay. And you should enjoy the construction aspect. It shouldn't be a negative experience. So that said, I hope that those of you who are experienced in sewing and have done work with pattern making, I ask that you at least be willing to give advice and tips to other people, as many of you have done here, so that we can all enjoy the experience and not get bogged down in the minutiae that is pattern making. So with that, does anybody have any last minute questions, comments, concerns, suggestions, anything else?
What's the website
yes.
that you for the video?
Yes, I will put that up here. And I will also add that on our website, there is an entire page dedicated to tutorials, not necessarily just by us, but by many, many other talented cosplayers. And our website is cospod.org. CosPod is a cosplay podcast. And we will be putting not only this, but almost all of the other cosplay panels that were here at A-Kon. We filmed them. They will be up on our YouTube channel if you happen to miss any of them. If you want to email us, the email address is just podcast@cospod.org. And we will be happy to answer any other questions or point you to resources as you need them. So with that, I would like to say thank you for coming. I do appreciate you guys spending Saturday morning with me. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the convention. Incidentally, if you guys want to write down the titles of any of these books that I have, I did bring 3 patterning books. If you want to pick them up, you can come and get the titles of these. I highly recommend all 3 of them. You can always be able to take a picture with your smartphone, and that way you'll have the titles. Renee Barron is the sure. That's how I learned to make all my stickers.
Making this list.
She actually has an entire series of products. I don't know if you can do that. And how to all that.
Excuse me.
Which I found is really cool. I find the more and more I do cosplay, the more complicated the pattern gets. And it's getting harder and harder to find commercial patterns of it, just like I want them to. So now I have to make my own. I enjoy it. It's a lot of fun. It does take a lot of time. And sometimes I get really upset when I'm just scrolling. But I can't. I never find the 60, even if there is such a thing, to be honest, unless I go to a place like Baltimore, where they have it in spools, and then it's like home decor, like that's like 108 inches. It's like, no, that's way too, I can't even picture the rod in my car.
They have that in the Golden Door?
Uh-huh.
I need to actually hear yes. going there. I've always been going to Joanne's.
They have both bolts, and they have the long, overarching length rods of the fabric, which are fantastic. Usually what you'll want to do is watch their website because they have 15-25% off sales on occasion. And it's a lot cheaper when you do it that way because you'll want to buy in bulk. Because that way you don't have to keep going back to the fabric distributor. And if you don't find what you need at full door, that entire area is a fabric distribution center. So you can always just go a couple of warehouses down the road and it's a whole lot of fabric store. Just like gold or so if you don't find what you need, just do a little bit of footwork, and you should be able to find what you need. I hear there's some fantastic satin sellers down there. I just haven't had time to go yet with school.
I will keep that in mind.
Really?